What's up, crafties, bots, all the people in the chat room, Potato Brain, Virgilio. Ooh, Virgilio's new. What's up, homie? Welcome back to Sketchcraft Live. I am Rob Duenas, a.k.a. Sketchcraft himself, here to talk about the Mega Visions cover that I recently did. We're going to do a little speed paint here, a little commentary. To join me on this grand adventure, the people who gave me some moolahs to make this, Seganers from Seganers.com. We got Chris and Graham. Say hello, Chris.
How's it going, man? I'm glad to be here on your show. I think it's the second time we've done this, so I'm looking forward to it.
And Chris, you're would you say editor in chief? What's your title? What's your official lord?
Yeah, I'm the editor in chief of Mega Visions here. So Chris, I'm the I guess the main guy.
Chris cuts the checks. And Graham, you make the images? Is that what you do?
Yeah, hi. I guess I'm production manager and lead designer on Mega Visions. So yeah, I sort of lay out the pages and try and make it look vaguely fancy in areas, but there we go.
Super sweet. All right, so this is the final cover. This is what we actually did here live on the streams. The final image that will appear in the magazine, full 11x17 version. And so now I'm going to drag over ye old video. And so, you know, from Ruffy to final was about 30 hours of effort, folks, for this piece. For a couple of reasons. Normally I'd say it's a little long. I'd say from drawing to color, it takes me about closer to 20 to 24. But on this piece, I did a couple new techniques. One, I tried to make my pencils, I won't say clean, but more print ready. And then I did a coloring technique directly over them using a classic comic technique called cuts and grads, which I am deeply unfamiliar with in terms of execution. But guys, I wanted to increase the quality on this cover. And I feel that the end result would justify the effort here. So
it looks absolutely amazing, man. That we were blown away when we saw it.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, I appreciate that. Thanks. And let's get into it. So I'm gonna jump right here to this video. Let's see if I can reset give me 1 second. We're doing it live, folks. All right, cool. And we're gonna start with the Ruffy lines and just kind of go over this for about 20 minutes or so, and then jump to the pencils, and then we'll jump to the colors. So we'll do this about an hour. We're not gonna eat up 3 hours of time. So here, I'm just going to go ahead and hit play, and then feel free to explain, Chris, you know, why Yakuza? What's the game? What's the point? Why did you guys decide to go with Yakuza for issue 2 of Mega Visions?
Sure thing. So this is going to be a big year for the Yakuza franchise. I mean, Yakuza 0 is literally coming out Tuesday, and this is a prequel to the entire series. It originally began on the PlayStation 2, and Graham, what was it, around like 2004 or 5 the first game came out, I want to say? Does that sound about right? So.
Around that time, yeah. I think it's in Japan it was 2005. I think in the West it was 2006 it came out.
Okay.
So it's nearly a year later they came out, but yeah, 2005 is when it first came out.
Right. So it's essentially like a Yakuza simulator of sorts. Like you are in the Japanese Yakuza, which is the kind of their version of the mafia here. But it's really interesting because you learn a lot about that whole culture, that subculture of Japan that you don't really get a lot of, especially here in the West. We're not exposed to that very often. And so you get to really learn a lot of interesting things about the Japanese culture that you don't typically see in a video game. And just the game is a lot of fun. There's a ton of side quests and all these just wacky things to do that kind of has separated the Yakuza series from a lot of other games. It's an open world game and third person, so you see your character running around and you have to do a lot of different various tasks, but there's a lot of fun things that you can go into too. You can go to an arcade and actually play Sega arcade games like Hang On and Space Harrier and things like that. You can go to batting cages, you can go play darts, you can go do karaoke, and so there's all these different little sub games within the overarching game, and it makes it really fun, and they're just really big, full-fledged stories that are told within it.
Yeah, Chris, it seems to me that the Yakuza series is kind of like a financially, from Sega's point of view, like a financially viable version of Shenmue. Like, like it's not quite as big in scale. It's like manageable to them, you know. Like, it's not a game that series is going to break the entire company and take away the Dreamcast from us forever. But there's this cool part. So when you guys said, "Hey, we're going to do the new," is it? Yeah, you're covering Yakuza 0 or 6 or both. In the
so in this issue, we're having the a review for Yakuza 0, a preview for Yakuza 6, which just came out in Japan, and it's going to be coming out. Actually, I don't think it has a release date. No, it does. It, I think at the end of the year, or 2018, it does. And then we have a retrospective on the original Yakuza on the PlayStation 2 that we talked about. So this is kind of, it's very Yakuza-themed for this issue.
Nice. And so since this game sort of appeared on PlayStation, you know, and the magazine sort of focuses on Sega games across platforms, folks, not just like, you know, Genesis, Dreamcast, and then nothing.
Right.
I wanted to, I took a look at the game and I was familiar with the series. I hadn't played it, but I was familiar with it. And the thing that always struck me was the fact that you could go into the Club Sega arcade games and play like the actual arcade. You know, they'd recreate the actual arcade exteriors to hang on and Outrun and Space Harrier. I have a deep love for classic arcade games. I don't miss the heat. I don't miss the heat and the smells in an arcade so much.
Right. Yeah.
I'd forgotten. I went to the last E3 I went to was when they debuted the 3D stuff. You know, PlayStation 3D was not the last one, but it was one of them. And they had them all set up on these screens. And I was like, oh, this is like an arcade. Oh, the fucking heat. Like, I forgot how crazy heat it gets. So I wanted to do an arcade. I thought it'd be cool to put these characters with their guns and stuff and their weapons in the arcade and try and work in some of these little mini arcade plushies. And generally what I do when I start is I create a color roughie, a nice color comp roughie. And if I hit pause really quick here, I can kind of jump over here to the roughie. Let's see, which one do we have here? This is what the color roughie would look like, and this is what I would send you guys. Actually, I think I sent this to you before I moved, right?
I think so. And we actually use, I don't know if this is the one you're going to show, but we used, so we use this as like the final page in that first issue as just kind of a preview, giving people kind of a sneak peek at what's to come in issue 2. And so people are pretty excited that we're going to be covering lots of Yakuza stuff in this issue.
So I did this as just a basic idea of them in an arcade, and this kind of, there's a lot of weirdness going on here, but I know what this stuff looks like. I'm like, these will be arcade cabinets. And you guys just go, okay, Rob, sure. All right. And then you just sort of trust that I'll draw it. And then I take that into Photoshop again, turn the opacity down, remove the color and just use my lines and kind of go over those pieces and create a what I call the roughy lines that I'll then we're trying to work out the construction of all the figures and then get their faces down pretty well and then I'll take this and print this out onto my paper, which right now I'm drawing on 67 pound cardstock. It's like a toothy, real toothy, heavier piece of paper because I'm drawing it with red mechanical lead and ink, and I'll get to that in a minute. But this roughy line portion is a little tricky because I have to build the arcade first and then shove the characters in there. In digital, you know some of the mistakes people make when they do a digital drawing is they'll start drawing a figure and draw the background around the figure. And you ever notice sometimes when you see that kind of art, you see like that chair looks weird or something doesn't fit right. Yeah, and that's because, you know, when you make 3D movies or you build a game, you kind of build the volume first, the environment, and then put characters into there. And in art, sometimes we kind of jump right to the characters because that's the fun part. And then they kind of just draw what they need to around it, and it doesn't always line up. So the thing, though, is because of this particular angle, the dynamics of it, I want the 45-degree, sort of a curvilinear perspective. Not really. I call it anime perspective, right? Which sort of swooshes around, like low angle. Adds a little more dynamics to the space. But because I'm drawn digitally, you can spend a lot of time needlessly trying to make things perfect. So I try to draw with a thicker brush, and knowing that, see how thick this are. These arcade cabinets are drawn. Those lines aren't going to be that thick when I draw it. So that leaves you, when you go to draw something, with a lot of extra space. And you need to be aware of that as you draw along. And that's just something that I've learned over the years. These guns, too, I kind of block in with the giant shadow. And I won't actually draw them digitally. I'll just leave the shadow there, a silhouette. When I print that out, I'll figure out all the details on the page. Because it's just a lot easier with that kind of perspective just to deal with it when it's actually tangible on the paper. But I remember we were talking initially, Chris, when I was like, yeah, I'll just draw some arcade stuff. And you were like, are you going to put a lot of Sega in? I'm like, oh, there'll be a lot of Sega in there. Like, thank God there's this fucking arcade. You know? Go ahead.
When you pitched the idea, I thought it was great because, I mean, going to the arcade and doing these things is something that was, I mean, that's what everyone loves to do. I think in the original games, you could go in the arcade and look around, but you couldn't actually play them. Right, Graham?
Yeah, that's right. I don't think any of the actual arcade games were playable, really. It's been a while since I played the first couple of games, actually, so I can't really remember. But yeah, it wasn't because it came out after Shenmue, and like Shenmue had the arcade games. It's like you go into an arcade, you think, oh, are there going to be arcade games to play? And as far as I remember, there weren't. And that was kind of a disappointment for the first couple of games. The games were amazing, by the way, but I think there was that as you mentioned before, that some people compare it to Shenmue, and because it was missing that factor, it felt a bit like, oh. But it's still great games, and yeah, and now the fact that you can play the arcade games is just awesome, and it's all... It makes you feel more nostalgic from a real life perspective of going back into arcades and playing games in the arcades, but you're doing it in a video game.
I wonder if that's some weird like archaic like business decision at the time. Like they're like, we know we have the arcade Sega greatest hits on the PlayStation 2. We can't be putting free versions of those in this game. It'll cannibalize the sales of our, you know, you know, kind of the way Nintendo's thinking right now, you know, like we can't possibly just give people a free Nintendo game because they won't buy it again. You know what I mean? No one buys Nintendo games twice. Right? Right. Sure.
It's going to be Balloon Fight and...
Oh, I know, right? So, but yeah, you know, the thing is I'm glad that they're including that sort of stuff in here and in their games because, you know, Sega does, it's one of the few companies that has 30, almost 40 years of real hardcore gaming culture. You know what I mean? Like, and we're not dead yet. We got another good 30, 40 years before we start, you know, effectively dying off. And so they got some time to build off that and put that stuff in there. Also, the director of this game, didn't he directed, I know he created Monkey Ball, and I want to say he created, I think the original Hang On and Outrun. I want to say those games. But he actually had a hand in a lot of the games that appear in here. Like, I know you worked on Virtual Fighter and shit like that, so...
Yeah, Nagoshi's been around for a long time. I don't know... I guess he was... Yeah, he played some role in Daytona, Super Monkey Ball. He also was big on in the F-Zero GX when Sega developed that for Nintendo. So he's, you know, he's been around for a long time.
Yeah, he did... I think he worked in Daytona as well with Memories and Scud Race in the arcade, Memory serves well. And also the excellent Binary Domain, which no one played, but it's actually one of the best Sega games to come out in years.
Yeah, I haven't even played that. So
it was good. It was really weird. It a lot of people thought it was essentially a Gears of War ripoff because it was similar to that, and where Gears of War that kind of like that duck and cover style of gameplay was really big for a few years. It had some similarities to that, but it just had its own brand of wackiness and just crazy craziness. That
side note, folks, I just showed this. So every now and then while this goes on, folks, you're going to see some random videos appear, and that's because while I'm streaming, we tend to have conversations. And this one conversation I was having at the time was I was showing people that these fans made this procedurally generated Sonic demo where it takes the first zone from the first Sonic game. What's the first? Green City, whatever it is.
Green Hill Zone.
Green Hill Zone. And it creates this open world procedurally generated thing you can run around in. And if you haven't checked it out, like, it's a really great proof of concept. And I got this whole conversation. I'm like, they got to make one where, like, you can run around the world, and then you can go into, like, you know, these little amusement parks, or, you know what I mean? Like, the core city where you can go get missions and shit like that. And then, and we had a whole argument over how that would be impossible. But it saw those, and then I was throwing out these objections from Phoenix Wright. I was like, objection! Like, I just, you know, I was totally disagreeing with that idea. But there was a side story in. So here's the thing: when you guys say, "Hey, we want to do Yakuza," I immediately go out to conjure up a bunch of reference and dig up info on every game I can think of. And with the Yakuza, I did find out that there was a side story where I guess they fight zombies. This is a popular thing in Japan now, where they make a game series that has nothing to do, a version of it that has nothing to do with the actual game, where they just fight random right. zombies. Is that it?
Yakuza Dead Souls they released.
Didn't they do that with Ninja Gaiden as well? Like, they did one
that
with
sounds
Ninja,
familiar.
Yeah, they did one with Ninja Gaiden as well, and it's a weird side story. Some of these weapons are from that actually. That because I think they were monstrously sized weapons.
Yeah, and I'm looking at pictures of it. It's weird. I own the game. I've just never played it.
Same
I don't know why. Yeah. I'd sit on my shelf, but I just never played it for whatever reason.
Potato has a question. Where is Mega Potato? He's asking about Brandon. Brandon's off watching football. So if you must know, Brandon's kind of a dork. So we're here. Us cool kids are talking about 30-year-old Sega games, and he's out watching football. Loser.
I scoped it out earlier, too. I was watching a little bit of it.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and just say, look, you guys get the idea with these Ruffy lines. I kind of work out all the faces and the details and then print this out. So I'm going to go ahead and just jump ahead here to the drawing portion. Now, this is actually where I work out the art. See this right here? This is me blocking in where all the arcade games are going to go. And I just put a big block of something. I'm like, and I labeled it. That'll be Outrun. That'll be Space. That'll be Virtua. That'll be... thing to note, too, because the logo won't be there on the prints, I had to make certain something went back there. And I figure that's where I'll put the dragon and some extra arcade units and stuff like that. I kind of worked some things that appear behind the logo. Let me go back to here. So this right here, folks, is the Ruffy lines printed out onto my paper in light red. I've kept the faces a little bit stronger, so I don't have to rethink out the details. And I'll draw this with red mechanical lead and Copic multiliners. And I'm going to start here with the first Outrun game. So I had to go get a bunch of reference for this, kind of look at it, and then I'm going to build. If you see here, I'm going to build the little construction box and just sort of carve out the little details. And I don't mind drawing super tiny digitally. It's easier. But on a paper, it can be a little bit of a like, this is a little microscopic on some of these details. Okay. The toothier paper helps, because when you're drawing with the Copic multiliners, it doesn't just blot out the ink. It gives you a little bit of drag, so you almost got like a halftone effect. You can kind of ghost. So here I'm just going to build it all using basic construction, guys. This is why I always tell people when they go, how can I improve my art? I might just learn how to construct basic boxes into perspective. You know, and each one of these is maintaining a perspective based on the horizon line in different angles. So this is angled one different way. And then I'll take this little Copic multiliner here and start to carve out all the details. And
holy crap, that is so good.
It's fun, right? It's more like sculpting at this point in a way, right? It's like
it's like I had no idea what you'd be drawing at the start, and now it's just like all coming into shape, which is awesome. That's one thing I envy about artists.
I appreciate it, Graham. The thing is, you know, I am up against a little bit of a time thing here. So I don't use a ton of rulers or ellipses unless I kind of have to. For the wheels, I probably could have, but it's so tiny at this point, you're like, it's you'll see, I'll go in here and actually draw the little arcade slots, the coin dispensaries and those little things. And I have a love for microscopic versions of things. And when I was a kid, we used to go to Knott's Berry Farm, and they'd be like, "Oh, here's these." They'd make little microscopic versions of like cereal, you know what I mean, like dolls and shit. And I was like, "What if I could get a Nintendo?" And my uncle would be like, "You in fucking video games, you know?" Like now, it's like, of course, little mini arcade cabinets. Everyone who wouldn't want that, right?
So have you actually taken like are you like working from like an image or a photograph of an actual arcade cabinet there? Are you just sort of using your own
Yeah,
sort of
no,
memory and imagination almost?
I keep a reference image open, but they're hard to get too, you know what I mean? Like it's hard. This Outrun was easier. Some of these are really difficult. Like Fantasy Zone really kind of wasn't in a normal arcade cabinet. It is and isn't. Some of those were like put onto a chip, right, on the motherboard, and just you'd go there and it'd be Fantasy Zone. It wasn't a thing. So, but what I am trying to do is create a little diorama base out of them too. You know, so like these little
Oh, cool.
dioramas. But there isn't any exact angle I'm using. I'm not looking at an angle of an arcade cabinet from this angle and drawing that. I'm just like, okay, so that goes there, and then if I make the grid, I can then I know it has these two speakers that pop out. So I'm looking at the reference, but I'm not redrawing any pictures because
Yeah,
I need
okay.
another more dynamic angle where it's kind of bowing. The image bows a little bit to keep it looking energetic. Is that the word I'm thinking of? Yeah, it keeps the energy because it needs to kind of bounce along the page.
Yeah, I think I get what you mean. Yeah, that's.
And then what you'll see me do here is I'll go and I'll add a base shade with the red lead pencil. And this actually helps me when I go, because now that I'm coloring right over these, this helps me when I go to color it, I'll just start adding the shadow where these shadows already are. And these shadows are based on the light source that I'm going to use when I color. So I'm figuring out the shade layer here.
So when you
So Sega's actually released some of these like miniature arcades like this in Japan. I don't know if you've seen these before, and I really want them.
Yeah, they're hard to use as reference though because they omit details
Right,
because of their
yeah.
size, right? Like, so I need like, and I gotta go see someone's personal fucking photograph of one of these things, you know? Cool part is Dave Halverson, the guy who used to own Play I worked for, owns a lot of these arcade cabinets. Like, he spent a lot of that good old money back in the day, and he bought like. And he owns the holographic Michael Jackson, or the holographic shooter games, you know, the cowboy thing.
Whoa.
He owns Moonwalker, the Michael Jackson, all the original ones. He owns G-Lock R360, you know, where you go upside down?
Way. Oh my God.
He physically owns. Tried to get him to let me to. He's like, no, I don't want
I've
to set
only
it
ever
up.
seen that cabinet once, and that was at the Sega World in London, and that closed down years ago. I've never seen that since, and it's the best thing I've ever been in. It's the best
Well,
arcade
they used to
thing
have
I've
it
ever
at
been.
Disneyland in the Starcade, and so I would go there and once a year, and I would just spend all my money on that game and just sit there and have to empty out all my pockets full of change and money, and they put it into a bin, and then I would go and just play it over and over and over again.
Oh, that's the thing. They just don't make games like that anymore, really. Like in the cabinet itself was the best thing about the game, I think. I mean, it's just.
Yeah, the two best cabinets I've ever seen was their G-Lock R360 and then that Galaxy. Because the Galaxy Force, they have the 3D version of it in the 3DS arcade.
Okay. Yeah,
That
I've never
actual,
actually played that, like in the arcade. I've only played, on the 3DS, but.
yeah, the Starcade had it right next to the G-Lock. So I could just walk over there, play that, come back. Like, the image is a little soft here, folks, because I have a webcam. It sits about, I want to say, 2 feet above my desk, facing down, so I have to zoom in. There's only so much sharpening you can do with it. Until YouTube adds a sharpen post filter. That's one of the reasons why I was trying to switch to OBS Studio, because actually you can do a sharpening filter. But not being able to hear the music doesn't help much either. So let me go here, see where we're at. Try to jump ahead a little bit. This is where I take some breaks. And we'll come here. Just jump over here. I'm actually blocking in all the other arcade cabinets now. Because they're going to be in the foreground, and these things are so tiny. I'm like, and they're going to rotate. So this one here will end up being hang on, and this kind of has to come out at you. So there's this through line I'll do where it kind of like angles up across the page. And I actually played this Hang On when it was brand new in the arcade in 1985. I went to go see Ghostbusters. 85 or 86. Might have been 86, but Ghostbusters was still in the movie theater. So they had arcade, and they had ropes, the velvet ropes around this thing. They had to, like, open the rope and let you in. Yeah, because they didn't want kids hanging out on it.
Hmm? You're talking about Hang On?
Yeah, Hang On.
Oh, that's awesome.
Because that's the first time I saw the Akira bike, right? Like,
yeah, of course.
I mean,
the thing is, though, there weren't very many places to go where they actually had the bike. I mean, a lot of them, there was the upright cabinet that just had the handlebars. But the bike, that was where you got the full experience, because you could actually move from side to side.
Yeah, I remember we went to go see Ghostbusters, I want to say 86. And it was there that summer. And I just was staring at it as a kid, like, fuck, what is that? Like, it totally looked way cool, you know? But I think it was $1 to play even at that time, which is insane.
That's crazy.
Yeah. So we all
it's a pretty short game too. I mean, if you wreck a couple times, you're screwed, and you're not gonna get that checkpoint, and it can be game over really quick. It's definitely a game that you have to play and understand, like, when you need to break, when you need to apply the right amount of acceleration, because there's some really sharp, like, hairpin type turns in there that if you don't hit it just right, you're going and wrecking into boulders or trees or whatever.
Future gamers. Yeah, the Hang On arcade thing, drawing that bike super tiny wasn't... It's the one thing that if I could go back and go, you know, man, maybe... See, I'm used to drawing all these a little bit bigger digitally. And then when they're not bigger, it's just that I can zoom in. So I would sketch them through and then kind of like here, and then I would get another pass with digital inks. But I mean, one, I already knew I took too long because you guys need to ship this month sometime. I think I was already a week behind schedule. And so I'm like, I got to get this down to where I'm just coloring over this stuff. And I felt that there was things when I did the Toe Jam and Earl cover that I did for you guys. I felt that the original lines I did had a lot of stuff to it. I don't know what's the word. There's a feel to it that didn't quite work when I went to color. For me. This is just me. And so I think moving forward, some of these things, I might actually draw them out. Because they don't take that long to do each one of these little arcade cabinets. They don't take me that long.
Yeah.
I might draw them out at double the size separately, scan them, and then put them on this, and then print them out at 100% opacity and just do a little cleanup moving forward, just so I can get the bike. Things like, if I have to draw like those wheels and that kind of perspective, that tinily, is that a word? So this is why I don't write. This is why I use a spell checker. That smallish. I'm Graham's British, right? So I'm murdering the language pretty well, right? So you can see the American school system is the best in the world. Like,
well, I mean, those guys add U's and weird, just nonsensical letters.
Hey, vitamin, man. You know, yeah. And the Australians call it Parmesan for. I love it. I watch Australian MasterChef, and my wife goes, "It's not Parmesan." I'm like, "I love it. I'm using it now. That's what I'm." So it is. It is oregano from here on out, folks. I just adopt. Oh, that's what we do here.
Aluminum. How do you say aluminum, Graham?
Aluminium.
Yeah. Like, does this sound cooler? Does it sound like it's worth more?
Something that should be on some sort of elemental chart.
It is. it is on an elemental chart, Chris. Chris. Yes, Krypton's on an elemental chart as well. It's adamantium that's not on the elemental chart. Word to note, this arcade cabinet here, that little thing you see with the wings, that's representing Fantasy Zone. Fantasy Zone did have an arcade cabinet, but it seemed to be in newer ones or in these like two-in-ones or some, like I was saying, sometimes it's these weird, they take these boards, these arcade boards sometimes, and dump ROMs on them in Japan.
Yeah.
You could see, you ever watch a game show, a TV show called Game Center CX? Graham, you ever seen that?
Yeah. I've never heard of that at all.
Chris? Chris, you ever seen Game Center CX?
I have seen it. It's awesome.
Yeah, so Game Center CX is this guy named Cacho, and he's sort of the guy who started the Let's Play videos where, you know, he was in his 30s and the late 90s, early 2000s, and they'd give him a game he hadn't played since he was a kid, like on the NES or the Famicom, obviously. And he would just realize how bad he sucked at it, and he'd have like a day to try to beat it. And so, that's where kind of the Let's Play thing came from, was this show. And then in between the different segments, they would go to different arcades that people could write in and tell them about across Japan. And some of them are really big, and some of them are just this little shitty, like, candy stores where they have a couple cool arcade cabinets that maybe they aren't even cool. Just people go, I had a lot of great times there. Then you go there, and it's just sad. You know, like Game Center CX. It's one of my favorite shows ever of all time. I even named the little slime in Game Cave Cacho after him. He's actually a playable character now in Mario Maker. He has a mint green trench coat. And for the 25th anniversary for Mario or whatever, he built a Mario Maker level and had Miyamoto play it. So you could check that out online if you want to see Miyamoto Game Center CX.
And I need to go back and watch some of those. So when I saw this and I saw the Opa Opa character from Phantasy Star, I thought you did it intentionally, but what's
Fantasy
neat
Zone.
About
Fantasy Zone.
Fantasy Zone, goddamn. Yeah. but what's neat about it in Yakuza 0 is that you can go do these like crane machines. They're called UFO catchers. And you can catch those actual figures in Yakuza 0. It's pretty neat.
Yeah, so that's why I also worked at a Monkey Ball, because thank God those were in those UFO catches. I love crane hook games. I'm horrible at them, but I love the idea of them. And I remember when I was at Play, I tried to work a crane hook game into what cover were we doing it for? We're going to do the Critters one based on Critters and Gaming. So we had Sonic and Tails. I thought it'd be great to have a main character who we could create a mascot for the company and have her play a crane hook game trying to get all the different plushies. It's 2008. And they were like, what the fuck is wrong with you, man? Like, just fucking draw. Just draw the characters. Like, crane hook games. But Fantasy Zone is one Cacho plays on Game Center CX as well. And I remember playing it on the Master System.
Oh, man.
A friend of mine had Master System. He had Fantasy Zone, Space Harrier, and Hang On. And I thought I was going to love Hang On. And Space Harrier ended up being that game I'd never played before. And when I played it, I was like, this is fucking amazing.
Like, yeah, that was great.
Yeah, that was hard not to not want a Master System after playing Space Harrier. Fantasy Zone was one of those games. We had a guy in the chat room, Hector, and he saw that and he goes, "Is that Fantasy Zone?" I'm like, "Yeah." He's like, "I fucking hate that game." Like, he's like, his uncle used to make them play it. They weren't allowed to play anything else, and it's brutally it's difficult. Brutally,
yeah,
it's brutally. I think that's a word. So it's it's brutal. It's brutal. It's right. It's super difficult, and you kind of go across the screen left and right, and it loops in on itself. Am I right? That's kind of how you play it.
It's deceptive because when you first start playing, the idea is you have to kill these sort of big bad guy things, and there's lots of enemies fighting after you. But yeah, as you say, yeah, you can go left or right, and the screen loops back on itself. And you've just got to get rid of all the big bad guys. The first couple you do seem really easy, like, oh yeah, I'm good at this, and then it just gets really difficult. I've been playing them recently, actually, on the 3DS, and I forgot how hard they were, and I kind of hate them as well.
But, it kind of reminds me of a game I grew up with in the arcades called Moon Patrol. You guys ever play that game?
Moon Patrol. Sorry, I love Moon Patrol.
Yeah, so you're right. So you're like, I love that. It's probably because it was a British game, but you're biased. So, but it had that same looping map, right, where you had this thing you could scroll, and you could shoot vertically and horizontally at enemies.
Yes. Yeah, but so you had enemies that flew above you and stuff in front of you. As far as I remember, it's been a while since I played it. But.
Yeah, but Fantasy Zone doesn't really let you, like, you have to just fly up and down, right? And so to add that
you get these sort of bomb things which sort of curve downwards, so you can sort of fire kind of downwards, but it's not straight down or anything. But yeah, it's you have to go up and down and stuff.
I can imagine being a kid, and that's the only game your parents get you, and you're fucked for 4 years. You know, like, that's your one game you got. Like, it's a game that really works in an arcade, and that you kind of want to play it for once or twice. I don't know if it would be like a $40. It's kind of like 1-2 Switch. I don't know if that's a $50 purchase, that game. Like,
I thought that was going to be a pack-in. I just assumed. I was like, okay, it's a pack-in game, but nope.
Nope. Yeah, full price. Oh my god.
Well, I think if it was a pack-in, people would be
cheaper.
Huh? I think if it was a pack-in, people wouldn't know why you don't look at the screen and play it. Like, you have to buy it so you know what you're getting into. You know what I mean? Like, ahead of time? Yeah, like,
that is kind of weird.
I just hope that that is not representative of where Nintendo's vision for the Switch is. Because if it is, I want no part. It's just 2.0, and I don't want to do that.
Man, it just seems like it should be a mobile phone game, like a smartphone game. You each download a copy of it, and then you just, you know, shoot each other or whatever you meant to do, not actually have a games console to play.
Well,
the game.
It sort of reminded me more like a game. It could have been on an LCD thing at Radio Shack back in the 80s. Like, you know, you put the Radio Shack thing down, you hold the fucking stick, and you go, da, 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 you know, and then I won. Yay, we'll do it again and pretend. So, now, speaking of that Switch.
Been doing stupid stuff like that forever, though.
But here's how I can loop it back in on. Because we're talking about Yakuza. We are. So during the Switch presentation, the president of Sega came out. And my God, folks, if there wasn't proof that Sega wasn't tied into the Yakuza in some way, you got to go see the president of Sega come out fucking bawling like a Final Fantasy 15 hero. I mean, he came out with a keyblade attached to his neck, like full like white leather pants, you know, like, I mean, we're talking super hardcore haircut. I mean, he was incredibly dressed.
That's Nagoshi, man. He is definitely an eccentric guy. And it's man, there's been a lot of rumors over the years of Sega's involvement in the Yakuza. A lot of people have believed that Sega's had ties to the Yakuza for a very long time. And in fact, Graham, what was it, like 2 years ago, there was one of the Sega presidents or one of the executives' house got like blown up or something, and they confirmed it was Yakuza related. So there's some weird stuff going on there, and no one really knows the full story.
Well,
it'd be funny if we found out that the Yakuza wanted Sega to make a video game based on them the whole time, and this is just what Sega's been doing, and it turned out to be super successful.
Well, do you know who John Szczepanik is?
No.
So John's a fantastic writer from, he made his name kind of a Hardcore 101, the game site, Hardcore Gaming 101.
Right, yeah.
And I brought him in on GameFan a few times because he was the only guy who'd cover GameFan and go, this fucking magazine looks amazing. This guy isn't getting paid enough. I'm like, I love this guy. I love anyone who says I need to get paid more. And I didn't even know the man. So he wrote a book where he kickstarted it, where he spoke to a bunch of different Japanese developers. And he spoke to this one guy who said that the Yakuza, because he worked at Sega, and that they had kidnapped his sister. So he brought a Sega arcade game machine and like with a trash truck and like dumped it in front of the thing and called him out. And there was this whole story behind it. I was going to do an illustration based on this interview. And at the last second, the guy said, I do not print this fucking thing. Like, you cannot print this story. Like, and I'm like, I get, you know, he says it has to do with the pachinko gaming scene, that's how they're involved. You know, that's why Sega has tons of pachinko gaming, and
right.
Konami apparently is way into that too. And so I was like, I always took it as like, well, it's hearsay. But then when I saw the Nintendo Switch presentation, I'm like, that is clearly the fucking Yakuza. Like, that is, I mean, where's Sean Connery and Wesley Snipes, right? Just to back this fucking image up. Like,
yeah, there's it's pretty crazy, man. That's I do remember that story coming out, because I think we actually covered it on Sega Nerds like a year or two ago, whenever that story broke, and it was really fascinating to hear about that. It's too bad that you guys couldn't do more of that story.
Yeah, you ever get some freelance money in the coffers, you go hit up John Szczepanik, dude. He's fucking one of the most legit dudes out there.
That's awesome.
So right now I'm trying to draw this giant, what do you call this, the eraser gun? Remember that from Arnold Schwarzenegger? You all see that movie? You remember that one? No? So the eraser, you remember that one?
I did not see that, unfortunately. That was like one of the few I have not seen.
Yeah, it was either that or Independence Day, and I got voted down, had to go see the eraser. So, fun summer for Rob. there was this giant gun, so I took the gun how it normally is proportioned in the game and kind of enlarged it about 20% because it's a fucking drawing. Like, I think when I first posted some of this stuff, we had a guy in the forum who meant well, or on Twitter, he was like, you really need to cut the style out. You know what I mean? Like, I'm like, Just focus on the way the characters look. And I'm just like laughing.
I did see that.
And he means well, dude, but it's just like, man, it's fucking art, bro. Like, there's nothing. I mean, by the way, drawing these guns, this is probably what I should have done when I was in the military. Like, like this is what I'm like, I could do this all day long. Just cut this out, draw this here. No rulers, no guides.
Back when you were in the military, man, we had like graphic designers and or artists. We had a whole career fields for that, as which you should have been doing.
Yeah, no, I decided to drive tanks, and that seemed really smart, because when you're an artist, what you want to do is stick your hand into a 120 millimeter round breech a couple hundred times a week, you know. Oh,
very, you have all your fingers.
You have no idea. So, but working these things out on the page, like the gun, is just way easier because of all these lines and trying. This is also why I don't like. See, if I go and when I had to ink these things, I did this GTA cover recently. When you have to ink these guns digitally, I have to recreate all these lines on the guns. Now, the characters aren't that big a deal. But on things like guns where there's tons of parallel lines, what you end up having to do is digitally making a straight line and then duplicating it over and then duplicating it over, building the big piece, making a smaller line, duplicating it over to make all those little edges, you know? So generally when people ink things digitally, they tend to go for that brush look, you know, that super fat kind of like brush thick and thin thing. Unfortunately, right. I'm horrible at that. So I was always into like Akira. And, you know, those, like, mechanically pencil-drawn books.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
I'm not good with, like, the one-stroke, whoosh, you know, that super technique. You just... so I like a lot of little lines. So this is one benefit to not having to redraw this fucking thing again, is that whatever detail I put into that gun will exist later on. I'm going to go ahead and just jump ahead a little bit here, folks, in the drawing.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, I like the fact that the gun is just oversized and things like that, because it's almost fits in with the style and tone of what Yakuza, the video game, is. You know, a lot of stuff is over the top with it, and it doesn't take itself too seriously. So I think it fits.
Moving into in this issue... did you get any interviews with anyone concerning the game, or is it just complete retrospective or historical?
Yeah, unfortunately, we weren't able to get any interviews with Negoshi or any of the team with that. So what we ended up doing is we just did a retrospective on the original game, and we had some old stories that we had done in the past, which we kind of harkened back to from Sega Nerds. We got a guy, one of our writers... he is just a super fan of Yakuza, and he basically, when a new game comes out, he imports it from Japan and plays through it entirely. And I don't even know how he does it, because I'm pretty sure he can't speak or read Japanese. And so I don't know how he does it, but he does it, man. He absolutely does it, and he knows like everything about it. So we ended up getting him to write up a preview of Yakuza 6. Which is the new game that just came out. And Yakuza 0 is the one that is going to be released this week here in the United States. But what's interesting about Yakuza 0 is it was developed on the PlayStation 3 and the PS4 in Japan. And so you can kind of see that in some ways. You can tell it's not a super next-gen looking game with like character or like facial animations and just some of the way the characters are formed and things like that. But Yakuza 0 was, as far as I know, was developed fully for the PS4. And so that's going to be like just an entirely new next-gen style game.
And yeah, Graham, I mean, have you played through a lot of these, or do you?
The first couple I played from start to finish, and I've dabbled in a couple of the other ones on the PlayStation 3. I got my PlayStation 3 quite late, but Yakuza 1 and Yakuza 2 I got pretty much when they came out over here.
You didn't get a second job to buy a PlayStation 3 like Sony recommended you?
You may act like they're doing you a favor. Like, you're going to love getting a second job and working, you know, 80 hours a week, so you get the benefit of being able to play this system.
I was working at Kinko's at the time when I was in college, when that came out, and he sat right there. He's like, just get a second job. I'm like, I have a second. I got to get a third fucking job. A second job shit ain't going to cut. $600. $600. PlayStation 3 when it came out, guys. Oh, 2005, 2006 money, right? 2005.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, so think about that. It's like basically $800 now. I mean, we really think about it. Jeez, I mean, play VR is cheaper. We could play VR. It's fucking expensive. I'm like, well, I don't know. PlayStation 3 was a beast. So I don't blame you holding out. You know the thing though about these games that are so huge that they add millions of hours of fucking time to beat is it's okay, I think, if people don't beat the games. You know, I think Shane R. Monroe is a guy I've been listening to for years, and he says that you know you sort of apply how much did you spend on the game to how many hours did you get out of it. So I think for him, his threshold is $5 an hour. So if he's gonna play a game 20 hours, you know, how much did you spend on it? You know, like if you're only going to play 4 hours and it's worth $20. If it's going to spend 20 hours and you got your money back, if you spent 60 and you could have spent 100. You know, like,
yeah.
So some games, I always beat every Grand Theft Auto game. Like, that's just what I do. It makes me laugh. I like humor. So if the Yakuza's got humor, I'll check out the new one on PS4, you know? But like Shenmue had some weird quirky shit in it, you know. So I beat the fuck out. I had no idea what I was doing half the time. Why am I buying candy in a store looking for kittens?
Yeah, you're gonna be
what
buying like weird stuff in this game. But when Sega sent us the review copy for Yakuza Zero, they told us like, look, we're trying to get this to you with as much lead time as possible because this is an 80-hour game. And at first, I was like, okay, well, he probably means, like, if you're going to do all the side quests and, you know, everything else. No, I mean, this game really is an 80-hour game. I was talking to Graham earlier today. I'm about 25 hours into it right now, and I want to say there's about 17 chapters in the game. I'm right around chapter 7, and so this is a very lengthy game. So, yeah, if you apply that kind of formula to, you know, $5 per hour, I mean, this and yeah, this game's worth, you know, a shit ton of money.
Yeah, I think I actually approach things that way as well. Like just the most dollar, like, well,
is that pound. A PlayStation 2 controller that you're?
Yeah, I give him a lot of those.
I missed that in the final art. I didn't notice that before. That's really cool.
Yeah, he's just rocking that shit. Clips it on like a lightsaber. You know what I mean? Just clips it. Because right. In my world, we just rock that on our belts like fucking fanny packs.
Why not, man?
Yeah. You know what it is, man? I grew up with Star Wars. I'm like, every time I see Luke Skywalker with that lightsaber hang, I'm like, that shit looks cool. I just want to walk around and fucking clip on a lightsaber. You know what I mean? Like, wish I could awesome. Do that.
Oh, man.
They were coming out with those Nintendo belt buckles for a while. Remember that? The NES controllers? That was like a belt buckle?
Oh,
that was the thing. You go into Hot Topic or Spencer's or whatever there in the mall, you'd see those for a little bit. I don't think I've ever seen anyone wear them in real life, but
like the Game Master. Remember?
That was a real thing.
The Game Master. Right? Captain N.
N.
Yeah. So Sega never really had any of that. They had the Sonic cartoons. There was that Video Power TV show that ended up having a weird cartoon the first season. That had some weird acclaim like characters in it, but those Sega characters.
Yeah, there was like Bigfoot, I think.
Yeah,
was in it. Like the actual car, it could talk, kind of like Kit from Knight Rider.
I think there was a few others. The Tomato Dude, like Lolo. It was some weird fucking double dribble dude.
They
got some shitty fucking acclaim license, and they're like, we could put Narc in there. Like, yeah, Big Boss from Narc was in there. That was the villain. So in my head, all those cartoons were connected because I didn't know any better. I'm like, sure, yeah, Captain N and Big Boss and Bigfoot and Simon Belmont's kind of a hipster, you know. Like
Belmont was awesome. I liked him. He was hilarious.
I have absolutely no idea what you guys are talking about, other than Captain N. That's
well, you had that video game show with the floating head, right? In the 90s, didn't you have that one, like a big blue head?
Games Master,
are
you talking about?
Yeah, there you go, Games Master.
Yeah,
see?
Yeah, that was awesome. Yeah, that was a show where it was like a game show where they talked about games and they reviewed games, but they also it was weird. It was like it was obviously in a film studio, like a TV studio, but the whole concept of the TV show was that they were on an oil rig, like in the middle of the sea. and the games master like had control of the oil rig and stuff, and he was just like literally a superimposed floating head on the screen, and so people would be playing games and stuff, and there's like an audience there like just standing around watching people play games, and they had competitions, and people would phone in and ask the games master questions, and he was always just really rude to them. It was brilliant. It was such a good, I don't know if you've heard of him, there's the games master was actually a guy called Patrick Moore, or Sir Patrick Moore, who was actually an astronomer. So he looks at stars and stuff. That was his profession. He was actually a professor. He had nothing. I don't think he had any like knowledge of computer games, but they decided to use him. I don't know why. It's just really bizarre. But,
well, that was the same formula they got for the Mario movie. Look at a bunch of people who've never seen or played a game, you know, and let them go make Mario. They never even looked at pictures of Yoshi when they made the dinosaur. Like, because they were shot out in the UK, and they're like, yeah, we just heard dinosaurs. We're like, oh, Jurassic Park, we'll get a chance to do like that. And it's like, no, it's Yoshi. Like, you imagine if they had made a Sonic movie at the time, and they're just looking up photos of hedgehogs, and just make a giant, creepy fucking hedgehog.
I would love to see a video game based on the movie, like a Mario movie video game.
Oh, making of that movie?
I want to see if. Yeah, video game based on that. I want to be able to.
Well, you're getting that. Mario Odyssey. So. It's pretty close. Like,
it's they're coming out with it on Blu-ray here pretty soon. There's a re-release coming out for.
You're joking.
No,
that's true.
Yeah. There's a movie you need to see on Blu-ray. It's definitely that.
They did a good making of too for that too. It's the same extras that were on the DVD. But yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. It's fucking weird. Weird. So
I know that Bob Hoskins like hated it though.
Yeah, but Bob Hoskins hated a lot of things. I mean, I always say you want to know how you've grown up, all right? You know you're a kid when you see Roger Rabbit, and Roger Rabbit is the best character in the fucking world. And you know you've grown up when you're like, kill the fucking rabbit. Eddie Valiant is the greatest character in the world. And there's a definite shift. Like, no kid likes Eddie Valiant. So, this gets boring. Yeah. So I'm just going to go ahead and jump ahead here and... Let me see here. Jump. You can see there's the gun. We're drawing some more gun stuff. All basic construction. I'm almost thinking with the faces, I might draw them completely digital now. I really freak out about the faces, guys. Like, that comes from working, especially with Dave Halverson. Anytime he did Sonic on the cover, he was like, "You fucked up Sonic." If you added any kind of personal inflation, you know. And you guys worked a little bit with Sega PR. You know, like they.
Yeah, and they're really touchy with Sonic. That's like their baby. Yeah. Like, so if you know that isn't right, they're gonna freak out.
Which is kind of ironic considering they've screwed up Sonic so many times.
I know, just give him a giant scarf and super long legs and shit like that.
Yeah.
And they will put that game on pretty much anything. If there's like a toaster with a screen on it, you bet Sonic is gonna be on.
Yeah.
Well, they need to make Sonic Egos. You know, shaped in Sonic's heads, there's like Egos and shit like that. You could put them right into Pachink. I don't even want to blue Ego. So let me just go ahead and jump a little bit forward to here. And we're heading up pretty close. So I'm just gonna see here, folks, with the background. Since it's already drawn through, I do the characters first and then I can draw the background. Right? That's me giving an art tip on how to improve a guy's art. Right there. He draws flat, you can draw three-dimensionally. So I'm able to only draw the details that need to be there because it's already drawn through from the roughy. And then initially, see, I hooked up a little monkey ball down there. Initially, I was going to add like a bar stool right here and put more stuff on there, but I didn't want to cover up their feet because then it looks like they're floating. So the limits of fucking perspective, you know.
Mm.
And then let's go ahead and just move right into the color. We can wrap this conversation up because we're getting down there. So let me jump over to the color. All right. So what I've done here is I've gone in and I've done my own flats. Now flats are a thing where I take all the characters, I give them a base color, and I make it so that all the characters are individually able to be selected, and then normally I outsource that to Brandon. Also, what I had to do is go in and grab game screens. So you'll see here on the Outrun, I grabbed game screens and warped them in there. So those are actual game screens that you would get in the game. And then I took the logos from the cabinets warped them into perspective and traced over them to get all the logos accurate too. Because I can't draw the logo Outrun that fucking tiny on a piece of paper. Also in the background, digitally, I went and made the Virtual Fighter 5 cabinet art right there. I only had to make it once and then duplicated it over. That's the actual one that was in the arcade, so I kept it consistent. And then see even Hang-On has a little game screen, and the number 7's on the side now, things like that. So some of these details can be done in color. You don't have to actually. Even Virtual Fighter has the logo up in there, which I trace over. I don't just put details in there. If I put it in there, I'll trace over it so it all has a hand-drawn look to it. And I put the actual Virtual Fighter 5 game screen behind her, which I'll use that as a backlight. And then how I'm coloring is, as I'm drawing all the shadows with the lasso tool. So this is a classical comic book coloring technique developed in the 90s. Still used today, but not to like usually. They do pretty simply now because comics are done on a budget. But back in the 90s, they're like, fuck budgets. We sell comics. We got money, you know? And so they used to, like, if you look at games like the old PlayStation magazine covers, a lot of detail went into those coloring in their art. And so that's always been like my template. Even for what I'm doing with you guys, is to try to bring back that, but also keep some consistency in the quality, because sometimes the PlayStation magazine covers, you'd be like, that month, they ran out of time. Like, so, you know, and I'm not bound by, you know, keeping on any kind of regular schedule. I just work all day. Also, this sign up here that's in Japanese actually is Yakuza. I went to the Wikipedia and got the Japanese version of Yakuza, the word for it, and just pasted that in there. So it doesn't say donkey dick. Up there, because you never know, right? What did you put up there? It's Yakuza. So Wikipedia got it wrong. What are the odds of that, right? I hope. And then also, I worked the dragon tattoo up as a wall scroll up there. I just took the one from the game, pasted up in there, and did a little touch up. I know Ashley West has a piece of interior art this issue, where she really drew the shit out of that dragon, and I didn't want to, like, compete over that, too. You know what I mean? Like, she fucking hooked that dragon up, so.
Yeah, that dragon looks really awesome. Yeah. And there's actually a really interesting story in this issue. So when Sega was promoting Yakuza 3, this was probably back in, like, 2010 or so. So Sega Australia, that used to be a branch of Sega. They're not there anymore. But they had a promotion where there was a contest where someone could actually get a tattoo of Kazuma's back piece. Like, the entire back piece would be done on him. It was like worth $10,000. And this guy who was a Taekwondo and MMA expert in Australia ended up winning and getting it done. And if you Google it, there's some stories out there about him. But there's not a lot more than that. Just when it initially came out, we ended up tracking him down and doing an interview with him, and he sent us some really great photos of his back piece and stuff. He's got some really interesting stories about now. He trains martial, like, MMA fighters, and they go out into Asia all the time. And he's got this one funny story where they ended up going into a public pool at a hotel. And people thought that he was, like, legit Yakuza because he's got this, like, back piece done. And they were, like, all freaking out and, like, leaving the pool. And everyone's getting out of there. It's pretty funny.
Oh, my God.
Well, I listened to Joe Rogan's podcast, and he's all into the UFC. And they were talking to Baz Rutten recently.
Yeah.
And Boss, so awesome. Baz used to be in Pride. Pride was his early form of, like, the UFC in Japan, which steroids were A-okay. So you want to see some crazy...
They were awful, like candy.
Yeah, you want to see some crazy fucking... fights, go watch. Like, the Pride was a cross between the old school WWF and UFC. That's the only way to describe it. And the turnouts were amazing. Hundreds of thousands of people would show up for these things. And he was saying that basically this guy showed up once and he said he was Yakuza. And they did like, oh, yeah, sure, sure, sure. So he wanted to get him a tattoo. So he goes, that's what I do. I do the tattoo for the Yakuza. I'm in with them. And he's like, yeah, right. So they go down there to go meet up with this guy. And yeah, he yelled at all these dudes. They got out. They're like, oh, fuck. And he was like, oh, shit. And so apparently one of the big Pride guys trained in this dungeon down there too. He's like, that's what we train so-and-so. I don't know their names, but it's a fucking phenomenal story. You're just like, like, what did you?
I heard that podcast too. It was amazing. Yeah, Boss. That he was a very legit fighter. And he had injuries and stuff like that that ended up shortening his career. But the great thing about Pride is it would just be freak show fights. They would just come up with, you know, the guy that weighs like 150 pounds would fight this like 300-pound. You know, sumo guy, and it was great. It was all about just the craziness of it, and that type of grandeur was one of the things that just drew me to Pride. I absolutely loved it.
Yeah, so
and a lot of that kind of wackiness is also represented in Yakuza. There's
that's part of the Japanese culture. There's some crazy shit, you know. And so I did work in a claw machine back there. See back there,
I saw that
quick little kind of fucked up the handle. But I was tired by the time I drew. I'm like, ah, fuck it, doesn't matter. So like, you're just like, ah, it's a claw. Does it have to be mechanically right? So what I'm doing here is after I get the shade level in, I'm working in the highlights. Highlights are where I'm trying to think of these surfaces three dimensionally. And so I'm trying to draw the peak area or color in the peak areas with the lighter color and then fade off toward the darker areas. There is a more efficient way of doing this in comics. Unfortunately, I don't fully grasp that yet. My mind, part of art is your mind grasping certain subjects. I'm used to working in specific colors. Especially coming from fashion, you usually have a PMS code and a specific color, and everything's trapped onto a separate color layer. Like I'll have a full adjustment layer for each Pantone swatch. So I'm used to working that way. The way they do it in comics is generally it's all on one layer where they'll select the base layer. Let's say he's gray. Kazuma's his name, right? So
yep.
I'd select his coat, and then wherever I want the highlight, I'd lasso it. And then set the brush to screen or overlay depending on the effect, and then you airbrush that in. And every time those brushes are set to screen, it'll get a little bit lighter and a little bit lighter. The problem I have with that technique is I don't fully grasp it, and I'm not getting the color. The color variation that I want right now, out of it. So, I think by the time I get to Mega Visions issue 6, I should have it all worked out. Like I'll have some mixture of the two. Where it works out. But a lot of this is like hard surface rendering. So the guns need to have a hard edge, right? And that's mm-hmm. where you could see me dragging that line across. And along that edge, I'm going to pop that edge out so that's lighter and then it falls into darkness. And his hands are a little bit lighter and then it falls into darkness. So you have a global, you have local shading, and then you have balanced light, which would be color that is in the arcade that is reflecting onto them. So right now I'm working on the local light, which is sort of up and to the right in the corners, the basic idea, more or less, you know, and trying to like add these little surface texture details in between. So the gun will have little bits of texture and detail that aren't actually using a photo texture. I'm not a big fan of that where they drop in photo textures over art. It always ends up looking like there's a guy's coat and there's a cheetah texture. Like that doesn't quite always looks weird.
Yeah, no, this, I mean, it's amazing just how much like this small detail adds to the overall piece. It makes it look so much better.
I thought it was done like 10 minutes ago. Right. It's just still going. It's just getting better every time you do it. It's like, wow. Yeah, it's...
Well, I was having a discussion the other night with some of the backers. They were like, you know, how long does this stuff take? And I'm like, well, one, not this long usually. But two, you know, because someone was asking about layers. You got a lot of layers. I'm like, you know, when you're watching a game developer work in Unity or, you know, even Game Maker or Unreal 4, you don't go, it's a lot of layers. You know what I mean? Make a game in one layer. Like, it just, there are elements. But in art, for some reason, you know, like, if you got more than a few layers, you're working inefficiently. I'm like, this is only inefficient if my mind doesn't grasp what I'm doing. If these layers are here, here's the thing. If your workflow has a lot of things to it because it's trying to compensate for what your actual talent, you're trying to like manipulate layers to give you something. Does that make sense? Like if I keep just adding more glows on this and hope that I somehow end up with the light source, then that's a problem because you're kind of like hoping the program will do it for you. Or if you just add more tricks, the program will do it for you. I've separated everything because my mind doesn't know how to do it all at once right now. I know all the layers. I know how it all needs to go together. So I'm keeping it a little bit separate so I can go back and edit it. And then what I'll do is after every piece, I'll go, okay, what can be simplified? What can be simplified? And then one of these characters,
I'm working on a Final Fantasy piece right now. Like, I'll take one of these characters and do them completely with the screen technique. So if they're fucked up, it's in the background. You know, it's that one character that isn't quite right, and I can get rid of it. It's a smaller piece. But I know you guys need something that attracts people's attention to the book. So I'm going to focus on it getting right versus being, you know, 100%. Like, that's just the fucking total way to do it. I don't have 100 of these to do right now. I have this one. So get it right and understand what you're doing. And then through, you know, repetition, increase efficiency with each one, you know. But speed will – efficient and fast are two different things too, folks, right? Like, you can be incredibly efficient, but it just takes that long to make it. You know, if you ever watch, like, those cooking shows where they make some crazy – you know, 100-story-tall gingerbread house. Hey, they're efficiently doing that, but it's not going to make it go any faster. Like, it's as fast. There's peak efficiency, you know. Like, so drawing these little squigglies on the gun as a texturing technique that was a little tricky to work out. You can kind of draw these little weird squigglies and then airbrush.
Yeah, I was gonna comment on them. There's like they just add something to the gun to make it look. I don't know, like. I'm going to use the wrong word here, but like I was going to say realistic. Realistic is obviously the wrong word because it's like a cartoon, but you know, adding a bit of a like to the material it does make it look like it's just a completely flat shape, which is really awesome.
Well, as more people get into newer techniques, I tend to go backwards. Like, I like the older shit. Like, it's just how I've learned this in t-shirts. The more trends you throw on a shirt, I'm going to go back and do some of the older stuff, you know? And you come to find out that, you know, some things just... that's like Star Wars is that way now, right? Some of those older techniques, yeah, you know, you can do digital enhancement, but if we just put a puppet on stage and then just enhance our mouth movements, it's probably better than doing it completely in CGI.
Yeah,
you know, definitely. So those older techniques require a bit more man effort, but the end result is I think there's people who can see it and people who can't, and I can't help those who can't. I want to wrap this up, so let me just jump ahead a little bit here, and so we can at least see the ending. One thing I'm constantly doing here as I'm working is I have the logo on another layer. I can turn on and off, so I can see how it's looking this way or that way. And that makes your job a little easier, Graham, too. When I hand you a file, the logo's already worked in there. You don't have to like fucking carve shit out.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Because you don't have enough to do, right? Like with the man. Also, I'll say the background is actually black and white. So the color's being generated by a gradient map. And a gradient map is pretty simple. It's an adjustment layer in Photoshop where you can take a gradient. And a gradient is where it can take two colors and blend between them. But you can make gradients three colors, five colors, as many colors as you want. And a gradient ramp means that I can take purple to red and to orange as one gradient, throw it on a layer, and anything underneath that, Photoshop will see anything underneath that in black and white, whether it's in color or not, and give anything that's black, purple, anything that's gray, red, and anything that's white, yellow, or whatever that gradient ramp is. So for large surface areas, especially in backgrounds, it makes it incredibly... So those windows, I didn't color those orange. Those cabinets aren't colored pink. I didn't do any of that. They're just black and white. I just separated them out. Because when you do flats, you want to separate everything out by foreground, middle ground, background. So foreground's dark gray, middle ground's 50%. I'm generalizing here. Background's almost white. Let's say 10% white. It gives you room to fluctuate. I throw the gradient ramp on top of that, and I get all those colors blocked right in based on the selections. So see, there's some efficiencies right there. You know, I didn't have to go and manually blend purple and pink and orange. So if I want to put something a little lighter in the background, like I want to haze something out of orange, I'll just airbrush white down there, and the gradient ramp will create that color for me.
Some witchcraft.
Yeah, I know, right?
I'm pretty experienced with Photoshop and stuff, but nothing to this level. And just the stuff you're doing is like some Harry Potter sort of Hogwarts shit.
Oh, no. I got so good with gradient ramps and t-shirts that I just started making all the color schemes gradient ramps. So when someone's like, we want something like that Obama poster, I got that gradient ramp. Boom. We want it like neon, where it goes, you know, the neon Star Wars shirts. So it's like pink and red and blue. Boom. You know, I would just drag them over, and then and then do everything underneath in black and white. And then my gradient ramps were set to PMS colors, so I could trap the colors in the channels when they were done and send them to a separator and be done with it. So a lot of my techniques come from learning things in fashion, which essentially is just screen printing. So, you know, colors actually have to exist. Like these strokes that exist around the characters, these outlines are called strokes. And when you work in apparel, those actually have to be there. A lot of artists will set a Photoshop adjustment layer when they're doing strokes, and it'll create a stroke automatically for them. But bad thing about that is the stroke doesn't actually exist. It exists in the ether. It's a visual trick until you flatten the image. So I'll manually create the strokes separately and then lock the transparency, and I can tint these strokes to the light source. So it's this pink here, but then as it gets by the arm, I can airbrush that stroke blue. I can airbrush that over here orange. So the strokes become part of the image, and they aren't just a giant solid fill stroke popping out too much. You know, it looks like a giant sticker. That's kind of the idea. You don't want to do that. But a lot of these little rendering techniques, trying to get these little surfaces to go this way, and I'm unused to this coloring process. So this right here is still all new to me. This is only the second time I've done this on this cover. The first time was on the GTA, which I just unexpectedly on Christmas. I'd already turned in the cover, and then on Christmas Day, I was like, I hate the way I color this. Started fucking around with the image. I was like, oh, shit. Oh, I could do it this way. And then I'm like... I know they couldn't have gone to print yet. They celebrate Christmas too. No printer's working on Christmas. No printer works on Christmas. So, not even in China. So, so they don't. I don't know. So, I spent my entire Christmas, despite my wife's protests. I made sure had her shepherd's pie. We watched her stuff. And then I came over here all night and redid it and said, hey, if you can use it, here you go. If not, I apologize. Just my own little idiosyncrasies. And they ended up being able to use it. And then I immediately wanted to come here. See, this leg, I don't understand how to get this shape. So I'm trying to figure out how high up does this peak need to be on this leg. This is a little bit of a trick for me. This is a mental trick I have to learn. You don't need to add tons of gradient steps. You just need to figure out where the highest point is going to be or where you want some detail to go or fold over, and I'm kind of using my underneath sketch lines, which are still in the image, to give me some of those extra guides. So as I draw this stuff more often, I'll be able to build these things into the pencils, so I know when I go to do this digitally with the colors and the cuts and grads, I'll be able to accentuate those lines. I can't guarantee any other colorists would. Like if I did this for comics and handed it off to a colorist, they probably wouldn't fuck it. They'd ignore all of it and just color fuck all, and I'd be like, oh no, it looks horrible. So, and then the final image, folks, I'll just come over here and we can wrap this up, is adding final strokes, which you can see here, and lighting everyone to the game screen. I want to make sure this girl could pop out. Like this game screen has this blue glow. All these little bits have glows. This is going to move too fast for people. They're going to get nauseous. Let me just slow down here. Let me go to the final art, and we can come here's the lines as they exist on my table, right? I took a nice photo of this. Here's a high-res scan of the lines that I've scanned in. So you can see this stuff's rough. You know, it's not perfect.
Mm. Wow, it looks good.
You know, and then, but this the paper gives a texture, which I like. I want that. So, and then we'll go from that to the final color. And if we zoom in beyond, you know, what you could see, there's the pencil textures are still in there.
Yeah.
Here's the lighting. There's the game screens. The monkey ball.
God damn it.
You can see all this right here is based off this light. I got a little light reflection here. It's kicking off this. I had little gleams to the, what do they call it? Oompa Loompas? Oompas? Whatever those things are called. Space Harrier actually has the cabinet art on there.
That's so cool.
Yakuza dude's got nice little gleams. And,
awesome.
So I was going to add some extra fucking plushies back here, but I just was like, I'm fucking tired. So even I have my limits. Total coloring time took about 12 hours, which... makes a lot of sense. Wow. Right now, I have this other piece that's taking twice that, which is ridiculous. So I am finding the limits of what I what is responsible to do. But I think coloring for 8 to 12 hours makes sense, depending on cover. Interiors, you wouldn't do this many steps unless you had two people, because then you could do half a book, which is how they did get books like Battle Chasers and shit back in the day. You just get two people, you know, but there's just not enough money in comics these days to do that. But you can see the gun. It's got nice, these little steps create this cool little, like, surfacing.
Wow, man, that looks so good.
You know, so you guys, you know, your prints are gonna come out fairly nice. You know, they look cool, and I think he looks like the character. It's not over stylized. I don't know what some people freak. You know, any thoughts though, guys? Any wrap up? You don't need to compliment me. I just, you know, any particular?
Yeah, no, I love seeing your own spin on the characters, because you, like you were saying, like, they're not overly stylized, but it's also like your own version of these characters. I think it looks really good.
I think it helps the magazine to have an identity. It doesn't look like you guys are just pasting PR assets all over.
And that was really, you know, and you and I talked about that, like, early on, like, wait, you know, when we were originally talking about the magazine, is it was important that we weren't just using PR assets, because there's other magazines out there that that's all they do. And, you know, it was very important for us that we have, like, original art done, like, super high quality, like this, on the cover of each issue. And this is just so, so damn good. Like, I love the Toe Jam and Earl piece, but this is, like, this is definitely, like, taking it up a notch. And I think it looks super badass. And everyone we've shown it to so far has had, like, nothing but really awesome things to say about it.
Slight Easter egg. This little shoulder pack is actually a PS2.
That's awesome.
See, it's got the little controller slots.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I hid that in there. It's got the little vents down here and shit like that. So.
And that's what's really cool about your stuff, too, though, is that, I mean, if you, there's so much detail and, like, little things that you tuck away in the art that if people really, you know, pore over it, they'll always, like, find something new in it. I love that.
Graham, you have any final thoughts about the game or the magazine? How's it going? You guys almost ready? You done? Yeah, you're living at your computer right now? Like,
we've still got a couple of days left, really, to finish up on the stuff. We did have a bit of, not gonna lie, we had a bit of delay over Christmas and stuff with the issue. You know, Christmas time, everyone sort of goes down, and I was actually moving house, which literally 2 days before Christmas, I got a new place and was like, so had a bit of downtime, but it's coming along well. It's good. The cover's looking amazing, as we can all see. I don't really know what else to add, to be honest. It's really good. Actually, I just gotta ask you a random question. The girl in the picture, have you used her in some of your other artwork before? Because I swear I've seen her in some of your other art. Is it just a very similar style that you've used?
No, I'm just trying to keep my faces somewhat, you know. In art, you know, you can draw an individual character. You know, it's just what I try to do is, when someone's Asian, I give them a manga style face, and when they're American, I give them more of a Disney face. That's it. Like, that's the way I work that out. A game fan. But they're Asian, they look like anime. If they're American, they look like Disney. And I solved that problem. I don't have to, because I never want to be a guy who caricatures the wrong way. You don't want to go like, I drew black people, they have big lips. That's fucked up. By the way, everyone here, they got lips. You know, I draw the top lip on white dudes, black dudes, whatever, you know. But if they do cross over into Asia, I just make them anime. And if they're in, you know, if they're a little bit more towards this way, you know, they go Disney. And if they're, you know, South American, they're Disney. Like, I just, you know, it's like a flip between the two. Maybe a little fucking Jim Lee in there somewhere. I don't know. My art style is somewhere between animation, anime, and 90s comics. You know, it's somewhere in between all those. There is no one, you know, I'm drawing like fucking this guy. So
I can't wait to see what the prints look like, because I'm definitely going to hang this on my wall in my office. It's going to look great.
Yeah, we got to talk over how we're doing all that. So
yeah,
that conversation. Sure. So go check out Megavisions. What's it? Megavisions Mag.
Megavisionsmag.com. Yeah, and you can if you want to check out the magazine itself. That was our website, but if you go into basically any of the app stores, you search Megavisions, you'll find our app there. It's absolutely free. You can check out our zero issue, which is also free. But each issue from there on is was it, Graham, $2.99 or $3.99?
In dollars, I think it's $3.99. In pounds, I'm not sure what it's going to be, because Apple has just upped the price of purchases in the App Store. So Yeah, actually, on Android, I think it's probably the same price, which is £2.99. But I think Apple has actually upped their prices, which is a bit annoying. So yeah, around the $3.99, £2.99 mark, you'll be able to get it.
Yeah, it's a full-color digital magazine with videos, all sorts of cool shit embedded in there.
Yeah, I think that's something. Yeah, we need to emphasize. Actually, a lot of people don't realize that it's basically an interactive magazine almost. It's not like a PDF on that you got on your iPad. It's actually been designed for tablets and phones, in that it fits the screen. The way the pages actually move and the articles move is a bit different. You can go up and down, for example. As Rob says, you can get a. We've got videos, we get like galleries that you can swipe through, panoramic images. We can include 360-degree images, which we haven't actually done yet, but we are looking into. It's like a lot of extra features and interactive stuff that we just couldn't really do with a print magazine or even just a standard PDF magazine, really.
Yeah, you could see a nice 360-degree view of my room. And it would be pathetic. You know, the same clothes every week. You know, it doesn't capture the smell. I got Sensi now, so we're all good there. But it's totally cool, guys, and we're going to do some more pretty soon here, as soon as we know what the next game is going to be and everything else. Go check out megavisionsmag.com, also seganerds.com. Links will be in the info. I'll have this live tonight. Real-time videos will be up through the week. There's like 8 of them, and I'm trying not to just fill up people's subscriptions with 8 straight Yakuza videos. So throughout the week, I'll release real-time videos, because, folks, we do have artists that like to leave them on while they draw or play Yakuza and go, oh, fucking Rob did some shit I didn't. I'll go fucking draw. So all the real-time videos will be up as well. Anything else? Chris, you want to plug anything? Is there anything we're missing here?
No, I think we plugged the magazine pretty well. I mean, if you are a fan of Yakuza or are interested in it at all, definitely check out this issue, because we have tons and tons of great Yakuza coverage in it. And not just that. I mean, there's retro stuff in this issue. We're reviewing lots of old games. We're reviewing some new Sega stuff. And we're actually debuting some all-new columns in this issue, too. So we're having a lot of the same great stuff that we had last issue, but rolling out some new stuff as well. And I think this is going to be, I mean, Megavisions is definitely one of like the most content rich magazines there is out there. There's just so much stuff in there. And this issue is actually getting even bigger. So you're getting even more out of your money that you're buying for that issue. So definitely check it out.
All right, everybody. So that's it. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments below. Thanks for everyone hanging out. Damiano, Potato, Dom, Johnny, Gamal, Brain, Regilo, and the random other dozen people that show up in and out of the live cast. Thank you so much. I'll be back on fairly shortly here on the next Sketchcraft Live. Peace, everybody. Say goodbye. Say goodbye. Say goodbye.
Take it easy.
Thanks. Thanks.
Seconders, Megavisions, 30 hours, fuck. Peace out.